about Larry motherfreaking Bird, all right?
Yeah, give it up for my cups, it got my eyes low. Yeah, hopped in the goddamn vet, then let the tires smoke. Yeah, 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 time nice villain, yeah.
What's good, everybody? How you guys doing? So today's video, guys, we're gonna be checking out another Larry Bird reaction. First and foremost, I just want to put out there that I really appreciate you guys so much for showing love on the Larry Bird videos. You guys seem to love Larry Bird, and I'm starting to really get into Larry Bird too. Like, seriously, the dude is seriously nice. Okay, he is nice on the court, and now I'm even looking forward to checking out other NBA players, man. So I'm excited for this, guys. Got a lot of energy today. If you have any other videos you want me to check out, you guys already know what to do. Let me know in the comments, and I'll try my best to get to them as soon as possible. But without further ado, if you're new to the channel, feel free to hit the subscribe button for me. We are super close to 8K subscribers, guys. We are only Michael Jordan subscribers away from 8K. If you know what I just meant right there, then you're a real one. Michael Jordan, you know, 2023, you know, you guys already know, man. But without further ado, let's begin this video.
Basketball is special. The size of the court.
I'm gonna just put the caption just in case, because sometimes, guys, usually when I like watch a video or watch a movie or whatever, I usually just put captions sometimes. It just helps though, you know. So hopefully it doesn't bother you guys. It's just me. That way I wouldn't like miss any words or anything important, you know. So.
And the lack of pads or helmets give fans the most intimate experience of a team sport that exists. And because of the different styles that basketball allows for, players develop their own distinct identities and signature styles through their creativity.
Dude's flying like that. Hey, Rondo was nice back in his day. Rajon Rondo was nice back in his day.
And athleticism. And although no player succeeds alone, the scoring volume and two-way nature of the sport give individual stars a nearly unprecedented amount.
Primetime Harden? Yo, guys, Primetime Harden, like Rockets Harden, that dude was serious, man. Oh, my gosh.
Roll over the
and I remember this. Damian Lillard, bro, the buzzer beater on OKC Game 7. I remember this, man. Well, not Game 7. That was stupid. I mean, the reason why I say Game 7 is because I know one side of the score was up 3. He even says it right here. That's a dumb moment. I'm sorry, guys. I am so sorry. But I do remember watching this game, though. Paul George was going against him. And if you guys don't know, Paul George, he actually went to my town one time before. Seriously, he was actually out here one time before. It was so crazy, guys. So crazy.
Oh, an outcome of a game. For this reason, players are constantly compared to their peers and to the legends of the past in order to answer the most hotly contested question in the sport. Who's the greatest to ever do it? For many, the question is redundant. They believe in only one right answer. Their answer. Others might have their own personal stance, but acknowledge.
Also, too, guys, if I talk a little bit during the video, I really apologize. It's just it's a bad habit, man. One thing I will say, I don't know why people want to say LeBron is better than Michael Jordan. Jordan's better than LeBron, this and that. This is how I see it. I'm going to put an end to all that debate, all that nonsense. You can't say who's the greatest player because these great players all play in different eras. If you could say who's the greatest player of maybe like the 2000s to now, oh yeah, we could say LeBron James. Is that a fact? Or like Michael Jordan, we could say during his time, like, you know, the 80s or 90s or whatever, we could say that. Greatest of all time is hard to really give an honest answer on because you have all these greats during these different time periods. And mind you, the NBA that we have today is different from the one we had a year ago. Does that make sense? Every year is constantly changing. It's not the same game. The game is always constantly changing. The basis of the rules, yes, shooting the ball, dribbling, yes, that's the same. But the other rules that apply to it, it's always changing. So to sit up here and say LeBron James is better than Michael Jordan, that's a hard thing to debate on because it's different eras. And then you got some people saying that if Michael Jordan played in this era, he would be averaging 40 points. Possibly. We don't know. It's just different eras, you know. But it's hard to sit up here and say one player is better than the other. Michael Jordan was great in his era. LeBron is great in his era right now. So
one or two alternatives.
Period.
But I believe that there's much more nuance to the question of greatness and more answers to it than you might think. By my count, there are 8 players in NBA history that have a substantial claim as the GOAT. It's a subjective thing, though. I can't give you a definitive answer, All I can do is make the argument. So today, I'll be making the case.
It's hard to make the answer.
For Larry Bird as the greatest basketball player of all time.
Interesting, man. Like the video, guys. Like the video right there, man.
When it comes to basketball, Larry Bird is the smartest, clutchest player to ever play the game. Now,
That's a fact.
You don't think that Larry Bird is the greatest basketball player of all time, you probably hate that I just said that. Those are the kind of talking head sport cliches that surely impact the game, but are impossible to empirically measure. Normally, I'd agree with you, but I think that when you talk about Larry Bird, you see those intangibles become real, palpable results.
One thing that could be an argument being made was some people, like I said, will say Michael Jordan is the greatest ever. Larry Bird, every time he played against Jordan, he always beat him in the playoffs. So it's a lot of things to come into factor.
About Larry Bird, you see those intangibles become real, palpable results. I wouldn't have said it if I didn't believe it. When Larry Bird was drafted by the Boston Celtics in 1978, the NBA needed saving. Attendance was in the toilet, the league had few marketable stars, cocaine addiction had several players in its grasp, and most damning of all, playoff games were being tape delayed. Playoff games at the highest level of basketball.
Tape delayed?
Damning of all, playoff games were being tape delayed. Playoff games at the highest level of basketball were being put in the back seat for black and white movies and network reruns. But rather than join the Celtics after being taken third overall, Larry Bird decided to return for his final year at Indiana State, a decision that would prove to be one of the most important in the history of the sport. Bird's final year saw the Sycamores tear through college basketball, going 33-0 before the national championship game. Bird, already claimed by the NBA's most historic and prestigious franchise, had established himself as the generational talent who would inherit the mantle of pro basketball. Indiana State's opponent,
I don't care what y'all say, 33-0, that is extremely hard. That is nuts, man.
In the national championship was Michigan State, captained by the immortal Irvin Magic Johnson. The Sycamores lost the championship to the more talented Spartans in the highest rated game in the history of basketball at any level still to this day. The stage had been set. The next decade of basketball would be defined by the rivalry between the white hick from French Lick and his Boston Celtics.
Larry is so nice. God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry if I pause a lot. I'm sorry. It's just Larry is extremely nice, man. And you know what? If you don't like Larry Bird, then you could click off this video. Because I'm going to talk whatever I talk about Larry motherfreaking Bird. All right?
Basketball would be defined by the rivalry between the white hick from French Lick and his Boston Celtics and the black magic and his Showtime.
White Hick from French Lick from the Boston Celtics. Oh, okay.
Lakers. The rivalry between Bird and Johnson is entwined into the fabric of the NBA and is worthy of 100 documentaries. In this video, though, we're going to be looking at Bird's claim of supremacy. Here's Bird's basketball resume. His three championships come with perhaps the highest collective degree of difficulty of any player's championships. His three MVPs came consecutively, making him only the third player to accomplish the feat, along with Bill Russell and Wilt Chamberlain. His two finals MVPs are misleading. He was absolutely the best player on the 81 Celtics, but he was only a sophomore, and his 15 points per game in the finals gave the media an excuse to exact a little vengeance on a legendarily difficult interview.
Damn.
His All-Star and first-team selections also come with the caveat
hey,
that
Bird only
played
12
for 13 seasons and missed all but six games of the 89 season following surgeries on both.
Did he just say he played 13 seasons and he got 12 All-Star selections and 10 NBA All? That is nuts, man.
Feet.
Wow.
I can hear you already. A 13-year career, and this guy is supposed to be the GOAT? What color of paint are you huffing, Clayton? Green. Obviously. But hear me out. Yeah, Bird's career lasted about two-thirds as long as it should have. But what he did in that time was so impressive and so substantial that every basketball fan acknowledges that he's in the conversation as the greatest ever. Doesn't it matter that those 13 years saved professional basketball, delivered a disproportionate amount of memorable moments, defined the golden age of the league, and produced a career by which all other forwards, before or since, are measured? Bird squeezed every drop of talent out in those 13 years and made it seem more like 30. He didn't just leave his fingerprints on the game. He left so much of his DNA in the sport that it needed a cigarette afterwards. He left so much of his DNA in the sport that it needed a cigarette afterwards. There's something to be said about the candle that lasts half as long but burns twice as bright. Those three MVP years stack up with any other run by any other player. I will put an A-plus Larry Bird season up against anyone's. What does an A-plus Larry Bird season look like? A full box score, a blowout win, a nearly undefeated record at home, and a play style that could only be described one way: white. Larry Bird isn't just a white basketball player, he's the white basketball player.
And he's a black guy in disguise, man! Come on, Larry Bird!
Bird's game is to thumb through the Hoops Dictionary and pick out every cliche about white players. Unathletic, great shooter, good fundamentals, the whole thing. The archetype of a white basketball player is Larry Bird, with one exception. He had an unparalleled understanding of the game of basketball, both as a physical contest and as a mental competition.
His look at this!
His basketball IQ infected everything he did and catapulted his career into legend. Bird was a complete player. Jerry West called him nearly as perfect as you can get. He was the league's first great marksman. He could contort his body to shoot from anywhere on the court, regardless of the level of defense. He pioneered the art of the dagger three and was the founding member of the 50-40-90 club. At 6'9", Bird's understanding of angles and coordination led to a higher rebounding average than Patrick Ewing, and it made him an impressively adept finisher in his younger years. In 86, Bird dropped 47 points on the Blazers, playing the majority of the game left-handed. His lack of quick lateral
It just shows you, man, like some NBA players, they can't even drop that much with the opposite hand. Some of them are not even good that much with the opposite hand. You know, I will say Steph Curry is one of those few rare people where they could do it with both hands. Like, shoot easily as crazy with his left than he can with his right and stuff, you know. But the point I'm trying to get at, though, guys, is just like, dude, to be able to do that with your left hand, knowing that's not your dominant hand, that you can just make the case right there. Like, that is talented.
Movement meant that Bird didn't do much when it came to slapping the floor and picking up the opposing point guard, but his size and omniscience gave him the ability to body similarly sized players, read defenses like a free safety, and pick off passing lanes with ease. His passing was transcendent, and I'll highlight it later. And of course you need to know that Larry Bird was a tough MF-er.
Hey, got a second? I'm gonna show you how I got the flexibility to code, create, and experiment my...
He had a superhuman motor and dove for loose balls like a beagle at the park. He was a willing participant in his share of fights, often precipitated by his league-renowned trash talk.
Leverett told Robert Reedy to stay there. He should have stayed in preaching. That was funny. He had 50 points.
I was guarding him my rookie year. He looked at me and he goes, "You can't stop me." And I looked at him and I said, "Gosh, boy, you're so confident." He proceeded to score like 10 straight points on me. The coach took me out the game. He walks by and he's laughing at me.
He was a basketball genius. He'd be a step ahead, a thought ahead. Play the game like a chess game.
I'd much rather guard Michael Jordan than Larry Bird because you have to
play the game. Wait a minute! When you play. Wait a minute! I know he didn't just say that. Hold on, guys.
I fought ahead. You have to play the game. I'd much rather guard Michael Jordan than Larry Bird.
Bro, you would rather guard Michael Jordan than Larry Bird. Okay, that says a lot right there. Whoa. That says a lot right there. Holy crap.
You have to play the game as a thinker when you're playing him. You have to get inside his mind.
If you put all of us in a room, you know, Magic, Jordan, myself, and Bird, Bird probably be the guy who walks out of the room at the end of the day.
Did you notice something during those testimonies? Those are some of the best basketball players of all time.
I know!
Sing Bird's praises like they were former assassins who had to go toe-to-toe with John Wick and they're just happy to be alive. Bird excelled during one of the most talent-rich periods in league history. The abridged list of his basketball rivals goes like this. Dr. J and Moses Malone on the Philadelphia 76ers, Sidney Moncrief on the Milwaukee Bucks, Isaiah Thomas, Bill Laimbeer, and the Bad Boy Pistons, Dominique Wilkins on the Atlanta Hawks, Bernard King on the New York Knicks, Michael Jordan on the Chicago Bulls, Hakeem Olajuwon and Ralph Sampson on the Houston Rockets, and of course, Magic Johnson, James Worthy, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar on the Los Angeles Lakers. Alright, there's no point avoiding it any longer. We have to look at Magic versus Larry. If you have Magic over Larry, it's because he has 5 rings to Larry's 3, had a peak that lasted about 2 or 3 years longer than Larry's, and had a 2-1 record against Bird Celtics in the finals.
perfect.
So, okay, so if you have Magic over Larry, this is what my opinion. I just feel like because he has more wins. And when I say wins, if you have 5 championships, you're more of a winner than another person, you know? He has 5 compared to Larry's 3, which means that he won more than Larry, but don't get it twisted. Larry has more talent than Magic. Is that a fair argument? Can we say that's a fair argument, guys? Let me know, man.
Perfectly legitimate, completely respectable arguments. But in the interest of making Bird's case, allow me to retort. For nearly the entire decade of the 1980s, the Eastern Conference was irrefutably the more competitive conference between the two. Considering the competition, for Bird to have made 5 finals appearances is just as impressive as Magic's 9. As for the head-to-head record responsible for Magic's 2 extra titles, he had more help. Seriously, the Celtics' Big 3 and the Lakers' Big 3 get compared all the time historically as if they were of equal caliber, but weren't Magic's accomplices just a step above Bird's? No disrespect at all to Kevin McHale and Robert Parrish, but Kareem was the alpha dog on the 71 Bucks and was the best player for at least 2 of the Lakers' 5 titles. James Worthy was the number 1 pick out of UNC after winning a championship as the best player on a team that had Michael Jordan on it. Throw in the fact that Magic got to be coached by Pat Riley, one of the most brilliant minds in basketball history, and you could say that the Magic Bird argument comes down to one thing, luck. So if their careers come down to luck, the question just becomes who you would rather take. Now, I'm not making this video.
I take Larry Bird. I seriously take Larry Bird, guys. Seriously, man. I mean, just Larry is just... Dude is just phenomenal.
To tell you why you shouldn't take Magic. I'm making this video to tell you why you should take Bird. Not just over Magic, but over everybody. One thing that helps him is the fact that his play can translate perfectly into the league today.
A 6'9" sharpshooter. Oh yeah, 100%. The way he plays right now, yeah, he would easily be able to slide in easily.
The fact that his play would translate perfectly into the league today. A 6'9" sharpshooting forward with eyes in the back of his head who averaged double-digit rebounds in an era against Moses and Laimbeer. He'd gobble up boards as a power forward, he'd be an offensive mismatch against everybody as a small ball center, and his off-ball skills and passing would pair perfectly with the flow of today's game. Add in his competitive mania and 3 generations worth of medical advancements, and we're talking about a player who could have stuck around so long they would have had to rename the league. As you've been watching these clips of Bird, I would hope that you would notice something. He always knows where everybody is.
Oh, he just slammed that shit!
Like watching those always knows where everybody is. Watching Bird play basketball is like watching those monsters from A Quiet Place that know where you are if you make any noise at all. Bird had a level of clairvoyance that bordered on the unnatural. In 85, he ended up 1 steal away from a quadruple-double after playing just the first 3 quarters. His passing was famously infected.
Quadruple was 5, right? Wow.
And helped transform the Celtics of the 80s into an ideal that basketball teams at all levels are still shown tape of. They moved the ball with precision and intent, always looking for better shots and determined to get the entire team involved in the effort. That fact is almost entirely attributable to Bird and his wizardry with the ball. This acumen also helped Bird become the only player with a GOAT claim to transition successfully into other basketball roles after his playing career. In his 3 years as the head coach of the Pacers, Bird won a Coach of the Year award.
What? Larry Bird was a coach? Larry Bird was a freaking coach? Wow. I did not expect that.
Bird became the only player with a GOAT claim to transition successfully into other basketball roles after his playing career. In his 3 years as the head coach of the Pacers, Bird won a Coach of the Year award, coached the Pacers to their first and only finals appearance, and gave Michael Jordan as much trouble as he'd ever gotten in his career in the 98 Eastern Conference Finals. Wow. After moving into a front office role for Indiana, he won Executive of the Year in 2012, becoming the only person to have an MVP, Coach of the Year, and Executive of the Year award. Wow. On the court or off of it, inside and out, Larry Bird sees basketball as only he can. That intelligence also lent itself to Bird's defining skill, making the big plays. Remember, NBA players get paid to win games. James Harden is getting paid nearly $40 million this year because he's supposed to help the Rockets win games. Victory can be achieved in a lot of ways, and the win column doesn't care how it happens. As Mark Sinclair once said,
"It don't matter if you win by an inch or a mile. Winning's winning."
But when your team is down...
It's fact, yeah, a win is a win. Take it, don't matter how you win.
Down one in a crucial playoff game with 8 seconds left, and you need to hit a shot to stay in the series and keep your season alive? That's where players really separate themselves and earn their money. Love it or hate it, it's the players that come through in the big moments that live forever in our memories. Some players, for whatever reason, were never able to do it consistently. Some players were truly outstanding at it. Larry Bird was the best at it.
Yo, that announcer sounds crazy.
I'm not going to give you the stats about his field goal shooting under 2 minutes with a score that's this close or tell you who has the most buzzer beaters or any of that.
Take that for data.
I'm just going to show you.
Drop the mic on that.
Moments in clutch situations. 1985 against the Blazers. Bird drops 48 points, including this. Down one with 2 seconds left.
Inbound pass to double team and Bird. Larry, fake, fall away.
Alright! 1985 against the Hawks. Bird sets the Celtics scoring record with 60 points with shots like these.
They open the right side. Bird the follow, eh? He drills it again. That's the best shooting I've ever seen.
1986
the
against the Rockets.
Record. Wow.
Not all of Bird's clutch moments were singular. The bigger the moment, the bigger his performance. In Game 6 of the 1986 NBA Finals, Bird clinches the championship with a triple-double in
My bad, guys. My freaking bad, bro.
Six of the 1986.
What I was going to say is, like, bro, you see the shot selection he just made? Like, how do you make? I don't know, bro.
Bird
like,
clinches the championship with a triple-double in what he calls the best game he ever played.
2 seconds on the shot clock. Bird wants a free out of
it. Freaking Larry,
1987
bro.
Against the Washington Bullets. Bird hits one shot to tie it before it's waved off because of a timeout. Hits another shot to tie it up for real.
Crowd is standing up. It goes now to Bird. Bird goes up top.
And I remember that one didn't count.
In double overtime, down one, yep. He does this.
It's going to go to Bird. He's got a shot. Get it. And it's got it. A 3-point field goal. And that's that. It's all over.
For 3 years, from 1986 to 1988, the 3-point contest knew no other champion but Larry Bird.
Larry Bird, yep. And we just check this out, too.
Still got to drop one here quickly. 14. This is a tie for the money. Yo! Larry Bird!
1987 Eastern Conference Finals, Game 5. Tied at 2 games apiece against the Bad Boy Pistons, this enormous game would put the winner 1 game away from the NBA Finals. The Pistons are up 1 with seconds remaining. The ball goes out of bounds off the Celtics. Isaiah Thomas just needs to inbound the ball to win the game.
Bro, how do you even do it? Like, oh my gosh.
There are truly too many big games and big moments for me to go through without this ending up as a documentary. But that all leads me to this, what I really want to talk about. 1987, NBA Finals, Game 4 against the Lakers. LA is up 2-1, and the Celtics need to win to tie the series and stay alive. Bird hits a 3 with 12 seconds left to go up by 2.
Bird goes for 3.
So if I bucket, yeah.
Bird comes down and gets fouled with 8 seconds left. He makes the first, but misses the second. LA ends up with the ball with 7 seconds left, down 1 point.
In the low post being guarded by Dennis Johnson.
Byron Scott is in the ball game.
Magic hits this, the baby skyhook.
Magic with a hook shot, scores with 2.
2 seconds left, down 1.
Dennis Johnson on the inbound. Bird fires it.
What do you think happens? I bet it wasn't that. When I paused the tape and the ball was hanging in the air,
it looked like it was going to go in. I'm not even going to like stunt with you guys. It did look like it was
going
to go in.
You thought it was going in.
That's what I thought too,
Bird
yeah.
Bird thought it was going in. Magic thought it was going in. I've seen this game before, and I still think it's going to go in. But it didn't.
Wow.
Pat Riley said it himself. We got lucky. And that, a missed shot in the NBA Finals, is why he's the clutchest. Because after he makes the big plays, has the big games, hits the big shots, time and time again, you expect him to hit every shot, to win every game. And in those fleeting moments when he doesn't, when he looks like a mere human, when he looks like everyone else who tries to do what he does, you just can't believe it. That's what Larry Bird did. He made the big plays so often, you thought he was going to make them every time. He helped turn basketball into a global phenomenon, paving the way for every Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, or LeBron James who comes through our lives. He played basketball in its purest form and captained a team that is consistently ranked among the greatest of all time. He has the second highest win percentage in the history of the NBA, behind Magic by less than one half of 1%, about 10 games.
Less than
he was
one
the complete
half. Wow.
Package, a player with no holes in his game whatsoever. They called him Basketball Jesus. He didn't get that name without doing something extraordinary. He saved basketball. And he did it by playing it better than anyone else. Here's Magic at Bird's retirement in 1993.
Larry Bird said that there would be another Larry Bird one day. And Larry, there will never, ever, ever be another Larry Bird.
Wow.
To the greatest basketball player ever, but more important, a friend forever.
Damn, look at Larry, man. He's about to cry there. Wow, man. You know,
hey everybody, thank you so much.
You know, looking at this, guys, I know towards, like, when we was getting to the middle, towards the end of the video, I didn't speak too much because I was really actually into it, but it just, if you look at this and you don't feel appreciated for what he's done, not only for the Celtics, but just for the game and basketball in general, then you're not a real basketball fan. Like, there was greats before him, like how we said, Bill Russell, Will Chamberlain. Well, I think they played a little bit around Larry's time, but, you know, they're a little bit older and stuff. But, I mean, it's just the skill set, you know, the skills and the playmaking, the shots that Larry brought into the game. People was just in shock because it was like, bro, we never seen something like this. And, you know, and then, like, with stuff like that, it's just, man, bro, wow. I don't even know. I feel like I'm not even making sense no more. What I'm trying to say is I do appreciate him for the game because I feel like the game, for what it is today, is a part of because of Larry Bird, you know? And who knows? Because Larry Bird, when he came into the NBA, that's when they recently just added the three-point line. Who knows? Maybe they might add a four-point line one day. You guys need to ever add a four-point line? We'll see, man. We'll see. But, yeah, number respect, Larry Bird, one of the GOATs. And if he's not in your top five, then what are you doing? Yeah, guys, hope you guys enjoyed that video, man. It's your boy, Flame. I love you guys so much. Tune in to the next one. And I'll see you guys in the next one. We out.